بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. عظم الله جورنا وجوركم بمصابنا بسيدنا ومولانا أبي عبد الله الحسين، وجعلنا الله وإياكم من الطالبين بثأره بين يدي الإمام المنصور المؤيد المهدي من آل محمد. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين. الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، يا من دعوته مريضا فشفاني وعريانا فكساني وذليلا فأعزني وجاهلا فعرفني وجائعا فأشبعني وعطشانا فأرواني. The first of our salawat in honor of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. The second in honor of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. The third with your loudest voices in honor of the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asri wa al-Zaman. Respected scholars, brothers and sisters, salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Imam al-Husayn salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. Allahumma salli wa sallim. Relationship with his Lord is best exemplified in the dua known as the dua of Arafah. This dua, without a doubt, is one of the most beautiful supplications within the religion of Islam, and indeed highlights the unbelievable relationship between Imam al-Husayn and his Lord. If ever you wanted to see the love Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam had for his Lord, and the understanding that he had of his Lord, and the recognition he had of his Lord, as well as the introspection and the reflection of the attributes of his Lord that he would go through regularly, then there is no supplication like the supplication of Arafah. This supplication, without a doubt, highlights the greatness of the mind and the soul of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. That if ever you wanted to see just the certainty and the greatness of the Imam, then the words of Dua Arafah highlight his position. Indeed, Dua Arafah is a supplication that could be read by a Muslim or a non-Muslim. Any person who loves God can read the supplication of Imam al-Husayn on the day of Arafah and feel that that supplication is a way in which they can speak to God. If you were to bring me a Christian or a member of the Jewish community, or indeed a member of any other religion in this world today, and you were to give them some of the words of Dua Arafah, you would find that they would say, who is it that wrote these lines? I want to know how he understood God in this way. Unfortunately, the Imam al-Husayn that we have built in our communities is an Imam al-Husayn that is only known for his efforts on the 10th of Muharram. if you were to ask many of the followers of Ahlul Bayt about the other 56 years of the life of Imam al-Hussein, you will find however many thousands of majalis they have heard, they would not be able to tell you more than 5 stories about his first 56 years on this earth. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam is not simply about the 10th of Muharram, even though there will be no day like the 10th of Muharram. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam has a spiritual ethos that can affect each and every one of us in the 21st century today, because you find today Muslims are taking many routes in which to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in which to know their Lord. Yet unfortunately many of the Muslims today have neglected the main route, and that is Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam are the best route for a person to know their Lord. Today we find so many Muslims using poets, using mystics, using philosophers, when if you want to see a poet and a mystic and a philosopher and more, then look at the words of Imam al-Hussein on the day of the Dua of Arafah. Therefore, when today in our communities people say, how can I build my relationship with God? How can I come to know God? How can I come to understand God? Then there is no better way to understand God than to read the supplications of the Ahlul Bayt, and especially the supplication of the Dua of Arafah. Indeed, if you were to ask many people who've come to Majalis in the month of Muharram, what is the Dua of Imam al-Hussein? You would find many who have heard years of lectures would not be able to tell you about the Dua of Arafah. Not only this, you'll find that many before they went to Hajj did not know about the Dua of Arafah. And that is a sad state for us, that Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, when they leave us these riches of supplications, if it was any other religion, I guarantee you their members would not have neglected the supplications. Whereas we have neglected the supplications of the Ahlul Bayt, and in particular this supplication of Imam al-Hussein, that there are many lovers of Imam al-Hussein who have not read or even completed Dua Arafah. Therefore tonight, let us open our hearts in order that on the night of Ashura, the night of Imam al-Hussein, let us take a glimpse of the relationship between Imam al-Hussein and his Lord that led him to being victorious in the hearts of every Muslim and indeed many non-Muslims in the world today. I'd like to examine this dua, the dua of Arafah, in the following stages. Number one, what is the history of the day of Arafah? And is it true that every sinner is forgiven at Arafah? Number two, who narrated Dua Arafah? And in which state did they find Imam al-Hussein before he recited this dua? Number three, what does Imam al-Hussein teach us about the etiquette of praising and not complaining to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Number four, how important is the words of Imam al-Hussein when he as a ma'soom even asks Allah for forgiveness? Number five, what are the lines where he reminds us all of all the blessings of Allah that he has given to us, and that in reality we should never be ungrateful of anything that happens in this world? Number six, what does he mean when he says, and when I was thirsty, you quenched my thirst? And how important is that line in Dua Arafah in terms of his philosophy of water in the life of the human being? And number seven, how did this line affect him on the 10th of Muharram? Let us examine this and seek to have a recognition of the meaning of Dua Arafah. The day of Arafah, without a doubt, is one of the greatest days in the religion of Islam. Many people may turn around and say, what do you mean one of the greatest days? As in, I know the 10th of Muharram is a great day. I know the 21st of Ramadan is a great day. Why would the day of Arafah be a great day? Historically, the day of Arafah means the day of knowledge and certainty. When the Prophet Abraham saw his first dream about sacrificing his son, at the beginning he was uncertain whether this dream was a reality or not, as in many of us see dreams in our life, and sometimes we're uncertain whether there's a message behind the dream or no. The first day that he saw the dream and he was uncertain, many scholars call it Yom Tarawiyah, yes, the day of the vision, but that vision was a vision of uncertainty. The next day when he saw the dream again of him having to sacrifice his son, he realized that this dream wasn't uncertainty. Rather, this dream was actual revelation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was revealing to him a message that that son of yours, if you love him and if you love me, then show your love for me by sacrificing that son. Nabi Ibrahim, therefore, as we know, took his son with him towards the lands of Mina, where all of you who have been to Hajj will know, Shaitan tried to get in his way by trying to whisper to him, like he's whispered to many of us, not to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, Nabi Ibrahim was able to get past this. He was able to sacrifice his son. As you know, in Hajj, they sacrifice the sheep. And therefore, you found that that day would become a day of mercy for the believers forever. That day, the day of Arafah, is so great that the Holy Prophet said, Hajj is Arafah. When Rasulullah says the whole of Hajj is Arafah, it means that that period a Hajji spends in the plains of Arafah, the whole of Hajj is counted in that period. Because those of you who inshallah, God bless us to go in Hajj next year inshallah, and we pray for everyone to be at Hajj inshallah next year. Those of you who Allah blesses, you have to first go to Arafah. When you go to Arafah, you have to be there between Dhuhr and between when? Maghrib. Between Dhuhr and Maghrib is the obligatory period you have to be at Arafah. Do you know what you have to do when you're there? Absolutely nothing. You just have to turn up to the plains of Arafah between Dhuhr and Maghrib, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives every sin you've committed on before you've come on this journey. Someone turns around and says, so hold on, you're telling me that I just have to turn up between Dhuhr and Maghrib and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive every sin? Yes, every sin. You're telling me, hold on, let me try and understand this, that I who have taken intoxicants in my life, I who have taken that which I shouldn't, I who have been in relationships which are relationships outside of Islamic law, I who have been abusive to my parents, I who have been rude to my children, I who have backbitten everybody, I who have even undertaken acts with the opposite and the same gender, are you telling me that if I turn up to Arafah between Dhuhr and Maghrib next year, every single sin I've committed against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiven? Yes. And you know, not only a yes, Imam al-Sadiq salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, Allahumma salli Muhammad wa alayhi, Imam al-Sadiq says, whoever doubts that Allah has forgiven them on the day of Arafah, he is a sinner and his Hajj is incomplete. Hold on. You're telling me that there is a Lord who loves me so much that all I have to do is turn up to Arafah between Dhuhr and Maghrib, having disobeyed him all these years, and then he will forgive every sin that I've committed? Yes, without a doubt. Arafah is the metaphor for Allah's rahmah on earth. If ever you want to see the meaning of mercy on earth, it's by us insignificant, rude, arrogant, hypocritical, envious creatures turning up to Allah, having Him inviting us, and then when we get there, Allah says, you know what? Because you took those steps towards me, every sin you've committed before has now been forgiven. Have you ever seen a Lord so merciful? For those of you who know the taste of the day of Arafah, you know exactly what I'm talking about. For those of you who don't, if you haven't drunk from the drink of Allah's mercy on Arafah, then you have not lived as a human being. Your life has not been lived. Arafah is the moment when you sit alone in a tent or in front of the heat of the sun and think to yourself, I who have disobeyed this Lord for so long, how much honor and mercy does this Lord have that He's even opened the doors of mercy for me? That day of Arafah is one of the most powerful days in the religion of Islam. And therefore you'd find that those of you who have come to Muharram Majalis this year, when you've come this year, if someone tells you go Hajj next year, You'll find all of us make excuses. And there are two camps of excuses. There are those who turn around and say, you know what, I'm not ready yet. Yes? You say, what do you mean you're not ready? Listen, bro, I need to enjoy myself. What are you talking about? You want me to go Hajj this early? That means, do you know how many things I've got to change? What do you mean, do you know how many things I've got to change? So what, you're arrogantly disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for fun? For fun. So you're arrogantly saying to Allah, you know what, it's my time at the moment. When I need to come back to you, I'll come back. That person who can afford Hajj but does not go, our seventh Imam says that person is on the verge of kufr, disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when our friends invite us to their house, we get dressed, sharp, ready, everything. But when the Lord of your friends invites you, you think 100 times about going? The first camp are those. The second camp are the ones who are thinking, listen, if you're telling me I get to Arafah, and I get to Arafah and all my sins are forgiven, then you know what? I'm going to have a good next 20 years until I go to Hajj. I'm going to enjoy this world, enjoy everything. And I remember that you said in your lecture, one day if I go to Arafah, Allah will forget everything. So let me enjoy. And then at the end, when I'm an old, crinkly looking person, then I'll go. No, not at all. That's another form of arrogance. For a person to have the audacity to think that, you know what, I'll sin and mess about and sin and mess about and sin and mess about. Then I'll get to Allah and say, okay, now it's your time. You could forget about that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks for those who look for Him. If you look for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then without a doubt, Allah will open the doors of mercy for you. On that day, the day of Arafah, we've sat next to people who have committed the most outrageous sins. Yet the moment you go from Arafah to Muzdalifah, you have now become a ma'soom, clean slate again. There is no mercy like the Lord of the religion of Islam. And that's why if anyone comes to you and says, you know what, the Lord of the Muslims is a Lord of vengeance and hate, whereas the Lord of Christianity is a Lord of love, tell them, come with me for 6 hours in Mecca and Arafah and I'll show you what the Lord of Islam is. Therefore, you found that on that day of Arafah, Bishr and Bashir, the sons of Ghalib al-Asadi, the brothers of Farazdaq. You know, Farazdaq was the famous poet who saw Imam al-Hussein on his way to Karbala. Bishr and Bashir, the sons of Ghalib al-Asadi, they were the brothers of Farazdaq. They narrate that on the night of Arafah, because you know most groups, they will get to Arafah just before Dhuhr or on the night of Dhuhr, you find that they say, we were with Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. When was this? The year before Karbala, or the Hajj before Karbala, Imam al-Hussein couldn't complete Hajj. He had to leave at the time of Umrah. The year before that, 59 AH, Imam al-Hussein performed his last Hajj. It would be the last time Imam al-Hussein talks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the plains of Arafah. Bishr and Bashir, the sons of Ghalib al-Asadi, narrate that we went with Imam al-Hussein to Hajj. And what an honor it is for a person to go with Aba Abdullah to Hajj. They go with Aba Abdullah to Hajj. They say, on the night of Arafah, we saw him leave the tent we were in, and he was in a state of submission and reverence. He then went to the left side of the plains of Arafah, and then we heard him recite a dua, كَأَنَّهُ مِسْكِينًا يَطْلُبُ الطَّعَامِ. He was like a needy person asking for food. Notice this line. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, with all his greatness, with all his honor, yet when he comes to talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first etiquette he observes is that, you know what, ya Allah, you are the all rich, and in reality in front of you we are all poor. Correct or no? In reality, who is the ghani and who are the fuqara? The ghani remains Allah. We are the custodians of what Allah gives us on this earth. If now I'm a millionaire, if I'm a billionaire, if I own half of Manhattan or half of London or half of Monaco, if I've got yachts in Saint-Tropez, or if I've got the biggest hotels in the world, at the end of the day, I'm just the custodian of what belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the end of the day, when I come towards my Lord, what of the riches of my Lord can I even compare to? Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, when he came towards that area, the narration mentions, كأنه مسكين. He didn't come and perform dua as a chore. In our communities, dua kumail has become like a chore. Thursday nights, if you read dua kumail at home, or you read it in the mosque, It's just become a case of, okay, it's Thursday night. Allahumma inni as'aluka bi rahmatika wa sallam, and then finish the dua and move on. A dua was not meant to be a chore. A dua was meant to be a moment where I say, WhatsApp off, text messages off, Facebook off, the Twitter off. Now I'm alone with the Lord who sustains and looks after me. Imam al-Hussein, when he began to recite dua Arafah, did not straight away say, you know what, everyone get together, let's recite the dua. No. Psychologically, Imam al-Hussein put himself in a mind frame that if I face my employer today, I will be scared in front of my employer. How about if I face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Shouldn't I have a bit of reverence when I come to talk to Allah? You found that before the dua began, the companions of Imam al-Hussein, what did they mention? They mentioned that he was ka'annahu miskinan yatlab al-ta'am. He didn't straight away read the dua. We saw a miskin, the son of Fatima al-Zahra. We saw a miskin, the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib. All of a sudden, it was an Imam al-Hussein who was different. We saw a notice, a change within him, as if he's talking to someone so important. كَأَنَّهُ مِسْكِينًا يَطْلَبُ الطَّعَامِ. Then they say he began reciting the most beautiful words. What did he begin with when he recited Dua Arafah? He began with a beautiful etiquette in Dua. What is it? An etiquette that many of us neglect when we recite Dua. Imam al-Hussein didn't straight away go to Allah and complain. There are many of us when we recite Dua, we're like, Ya Allah, why is this happening to me? Ya Allah, why me? Ya Allah, why is this going wrong for me? Ya Allah, why is this happening to my daughter? Ya Allah, why is this happening to my son? Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, when he begins Dua Arafah, does something beautiful. He says, if you want to get through to God, praise Him. Don't complain to Him. There are many of us, when we talk to God, our whole dua session is a complaining session. All we do, it's as if Allah has given us nothing in life, correct or no? The way some of us talk to Allah, it's like, Ya Allah, why is my daughter going through this? Ya Allah, why is my son? Why is my husband? Have you neglected all the blessings Allah gave you? Shouldn't you, out of courtesy at the beginning, say, you know what, thank you for this, thank you for that, thank you for this, thank you for that, thank you for this, thank you for that. Can I not thank Allah for my eyesight first before I ask Him something? Can I not thank Allah for the ability to breathe? Can I not thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the ability to walk? Can I not thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the ability to talk? Can I not thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I have parents? Many of us, when we recite a dua, straight away, Ya Allah, why? Instead of saying, Ya Allah, look at Imam al-Hussein, what he says at the beginning of Dua Arafah. Beautiful. He begins first by doing what? Let me praise you for all the things you've done for me in life. Yes? Imam al-Hussein, this is about a year and a bit before he dies. Let me praise you. Yes? Ya uddati fi shiddati. You were the means in every one of my hardships. Yes? Ya ghiyathi fi kurbati. And you were my relief in every agony that I faced. Ya wali fi ni'mati. And you are the guardian of all my blessings. Ya sahibi fi wahdati. And you are my companion whenever I am lonely. You know, some of these lines I'm going to quote to you, if you fast forward them to the 10th of Muharram, they hurt you more. He begins by saying, Ya uddati fi shiddati. You are my means in every hardship. Ya Allah, I'm not going to complain to you when I talk to you. Rather, I want to tell you that you truly are my means in whatever hardship I faced. If I saw my mother Fatima al-Zahra killed in front of me, you were the means that protected me. If I saw my father Ali ibn Abi Talib struck, you were the means in my hardship. You were the relief in every agony. When my brother Hassan was poisoned, you were the relief that kept me in a state of agony. Yes? Ya wali fi ni'mati. You are the guardian of every blessing. If I'm ma'soom, you're the guardian. If I have ilm, you're the guardian. If I was chosen, you're the guardian. If I am able to help, you're the guardian. Ya sahibi fi wahdati. And whenever I was alone, Ya Allah, you were my companion. Yes? I want to ask all of you, whenever you've read a dua, did you straight away talk to Allah by reminding yourself when you were in hardships, or when you were in agony, or when you had a blessing, or when you were alone? Did any of you ever remind yourself of who it was that looked after you in all those moments? Those of you here who've lost a mother or father, who was your relief in your agony when you heard your dad died? For those of you who've lost family, who was your means in hardship at that moment? Those of you who Allah gave houses and cars and riches, who is the guardian of those? You? And when you were lonely in a country and there weren't followers of Ahlul Bayt around you, who was the friend you could always turn to? When we were alone, wherever, in our countries or outside of our countries, did Allah ever leave us or was Allah always with us? Imam al-Hussein begins Dua Arafah by saying what? That before I ask Allah for anything, first let me praise Allah for what He's given me in life. There are some of us, maybe we've gone through problems in our marriages, in our relationships with our parents. Before straight away you say, Ya Allah, am I cursed? First say, Ya Allah, thank you for every other thing that you gave me in life. Now, Ya Allah, I want to speak to you. Because an honorable person doesn't come to a wealthy, kind person and straight away complain. An honorable person comes to a wealthy, kind person and first praises them, thanks them for all of their blessings, then says to them, this is what I want. Imam al-Hussein teaches us that don't do dua at home, because there are many people who do dua and you find their dua is rejected. And they say, why is our dua not being accepted? When you talk to Allah, did you say to Allah, thank you for everything He gave you, then you read a dua? Or did you straight away complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Therefore, the beginning of the dua, Imam teaches a lesson. You want Allah's ears to hear you? Then make sure first you praise Allah, not complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, then he asks Allah. And the most beautiful line in dua Arafah, which he asks Allah, is what? Allahumma ij'alni akhshaka ka'anni arak. Ya Allah, let me be conscious of you as if I'm seeing you in front of me. Isn't that a wish we all want in life? We know very well that we can't see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we'll never be able to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nabi Musa alayhi salam asked Allah, Ya Allah, the children of Israel want to see me. And Allah replied to him in Surah 7, Lan tarani, you'll never be able to see me. Not in this world, nor in the hereafter. When Imam al-Hussein says, Oh Allah, allow me to be conscious of you as if I'm seeing you. Does that mean seeing with the eyes? No. Ya Allah, let me be conscious of you as if I'm seeing you with my heart present in every moment in my life. Every moment present, Ya Allah, I want you to be around me. Because there are many of us here who have that wish that we want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if He's next to us whenever we're in a difficult situation. There are many of us who face situations where we're about to perform haram. If we had Allah in front of us, would we? No, we wouldn't. Then we know we can't have Allah in front of us, so at least let Allah be in our heart and let Him be present. Imam Amir al-Mu'minin used to say, I have never done anything except that I saw Allah before it, Allah during it, and Allah after it. Isn't that true? That whenever a situation comes up in my life, I always ask, what would Allah think of it? How would it affect me? And what would Allah think of the consequences of such an act? Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam could have asked anything from Allah, but the first thing he asks is what? Allahumma ij'alni akhshaka ka'anni arak. Ya Allah, allow me to be conscious of you as if I'm seeing you in front of me. I'll never forget Nabi Yusuf alayhi salam when he was with Zulaykha in that room. Yes, Zulaykha was running after him. Yusuf, the Quran mentions, would have also wanted to be with her. The Quran says, وَلَقَدْ هَمَّتْ بِهِ وَهَمَّ بِهَا. She wanted him, he would have wanted her. لَوْلَا أَرَّأَ بُرْهَانَ رَبِّهِ. Had he not seen the mercy of his Lord in front of him. When the Quran said, لَوْلَا أَرَّأَ بُرْهَانَ رَبِّهِ, what did the Quran mean? The Quran meant that if you can reach a level, you can't see Allah, but try and ask Allah to be present with you in every moment in your life. If I'm alone with a na-mahram in business, Ya Allah, be there at that moment. Give me that asma so that I'm able to protect myself. I'm able to look after myself. I'm able to remain strong. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, when he asks in this dua, Ya Allah, let me be conscious of you as if I see you. And without a doubt, if you look at Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, it's as if he himself immersed himself in this one line. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, if you look at his life, even going towards Karbala, it's as if he was seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala right in front of him. As in, you look at the mystical words of Imam al-Hussein on the way to Karbala, you'd think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was in front of him literally. When he left towards Karbala, what did he say? I have left the world for the sake of you. Who are you talking to? It's as if literally the veils between him and Allah have been removed, like they were removed from his grandfather on the night of Mi'raj. I have left the world for the sake of you, and I have orphaned my children so that I may see you. If they cut my body into pieces, each piece would cry out its love for you. Have you ever seen a mystic talk like that? You would think literally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in front of him in terms of his mercy and his glory. I have left the world for the sake of you. I've orphaned my children so I may see you. Let them cut this body into pieces. Each piece calls out its love for you. Another of his lines, what does he say? The illegitimate son of illegitimate gives me two options, the sword and humiliation, and I will never be humiliated. That's a man who has Allah in front of him. That's a man who is ready to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he knows the presence of Allah is with him. Therefore, the second beautiful thing is, after praising Allah, then Imam al-Hussein says, Ya Allah, allow me to be conscious of you as if I see you. Then number three, what does Imam al-Hussein do in Dua Arafah? Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam then praises Allah, all his bounties he's given him. Then he turns around and says how he has neglected Allah, subhanallah. Imam al-Hussein, if he says, I've neglected Allah, then what do we say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Imam al-Hussein says, you are the one who honored me, you protected me, you looked after me, you gave me, you blessed me, you gave me dignity, you trusted me. And I, وَأَنَا الْمُعْتَرِفُ بِنِعْمَتِكَ عَلَيَّ وَعِنْدِي. And I admit all these blessings on me and within me. وَأَبُوءُ بِذِنُوبِي. However, I continue to sin. I'm the one who neglected you. I'm the one who disrespected you. I'm the one who broke my trust with you. I'm the one who dishonored you. I'm the one who didn't remember you. I'm the one who didn't look after you. Aba Abdullah, if he talks like this with Allah, then what do we say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam humbles himself in dua Arafah to such a level where you're like, but Imam, you are ma'soom. Yes, no doubt he's ma'soom. Someone asks, but if an Imam is ma'soom, why does he say, Ya Allah, I've dishonored you and I've not looked after you and I've neglected you? Because there are different levels of istighfar. For me and you, when we say we've dishonored you, that means we've sinned. For Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, if they feel they've missed a subhanallah or a salawat in the day, they feel that they have neglected Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, when they say sorry to Allah, it doesn't mean they've committed the sins that me and you have committed. Rather, to them, a day where they may not have remembered Allah as much as they should have, they feel that's a day of neglect. That's number one. Number two, do you know what Ahlul Bayt saw as a sin as well? Mentioning the word I instead of the word he. This is a fundamental line. Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, when they would sometimes say, I am going towards Karbala, they used to see that as a sin. Why? Because there is no I in this world. There is only he and none else. So when Imam al-Hussein turns around to Arafah and says, Ya Allah, you've honored me, protected me, looked after me, everything you've given me, however, I've dishonored you, doesn't mean he's a sinner, but rather he's showing us that, you know what, this is the etiquette to talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That have we really honored Allah? Have we protected the message of Allah? Have we spread the message of Allah? Have we disseminated the teachings of Allah? If someone like Imam al-Hussein says that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what do we say to Allah? What do I talk to Allah? But the beauty of Dua Arafah is Imam's given us those words. Instead of him reciting, he said to us, no, you use these words. You talk to Allah like this. Say to him, Ya Allah, I acknowledge all the years I've neglected you. But now I'm admitting that I've disrespected. But now I want to come back towards you. And that's why the next lines after that, he mentions every area Allah helped him in. And one by one, they're beautiful. Listen to what he says. Ya man da'awtu. Oh, you who I supplicated to when I was ill and he cured me. Correct? Imam al-Hussein remembers that when he was younger, when he was ill, Allah cured him. That's number one. Then he says, وَعُرْيَانًا فَكَسَانِي. And when I was naked, you clothed me. When we were babies, who's the one who provided the garments for us to be clothed? وَجَاهِلًا فَعَرَّفَنِي. And when I was ignorant, you gave me ma'rifah. I didn't get it myself. What? I went out and I went to university and all these degrees. Is me? No, not at all. If it wasn't for your blessings, I would have no knowledge of you or anything that surrounds you. يا من دعوته مريضا فشفاني عريانا فكساني. Yes. Then he says what? جاهلا فعرفني ذليلا فعزني. And when I was humiliated, you gave me عزه. Every time I was humiliated, I was given عزه by you. You gave me the honor in this world. Nobody else. Yes. Then after that, what does he say? وَجَائِعًا فَأَشْبَعَنِي. And when I was hungry, you're the one who provided the food. Yes. Every blessing you have on the table, say Alhamdulillah, say Shukran Lillah. Don't ever neglect a meal without thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes some of us are used to such luxurious meals, we forget to even say Allah's name at the beginning of the meal. Yes. يَا مَنْ دَعَوْتُهُ مَرِيضًا فَشَفَانِي عُرْيَانًا فَكَسَانِي. Yes. And then جَاهِلًا فَعَرَّفَنِي. Then after that, ذَلِيلًا فَعَزَّنِي جَائِعًا فَأَشْبَعَنِي. Then he mentions a fitting line. وَعَطْشَانًا فَأَرْوَانِي. And when I was thirsty, you always quenched my thirst. This one line in particular is a beautiful line. Whenever we've been thirsty on a hot day, who really provided the water that day? Who really provided? Who originated that water? How many of us take care of all those in the world today who face malnutritions and famines and droughts with no water? Imam al-Hussein said, don't take that water for granted. Remember, when you were thirsty, Allah quenched your thirst. You now allowing that tap to flow, that sink to flow, don't take it for granted, for there are children in Africa with no water today. There are children in villages in India who the water they drink is mixed with dirt. They can't even have pure. And today we complain that it has to be the highest class, most luxurious, still sparkling. No problem. But don't forget that Allah, when you were thirsty, quenched your thirst. And without a doubt, Imam al-Hussein wanted to focus on this. Why? He never wanted to see anyone thirsty. If anything in life, he never wanted to see anyone around him, friend or enemy, thirsty. Because in Dua Arafah, he said, Ya Allah, when I was thirsty, you quenched my thirst. If I ever see anyone thirsty, I'll quench their thirst. On the way to Karbala, there were two moments he quenched the thirst of his enemies. Two moments. The first moment he quenched the thirst of his enemies, Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi, when he was commander of the opposition, met him. When they met him, Imam al-Hussein said to him, Hur, you lead Salah. Hur replied, O son of Rasulullah, son of Fatima al-Zahra, how can I lead Salah when you are here? That was when Hur was still commander of the opposition. When they finished Salah, Hur came to Imam al-Hussein. He said to him, Aba Abdullah, I need a favor from you. He said, what is it? He said, my soldiers are thirsty. Do you have any water? He looked at him and he said, of course, Hur. He turned around to those who were around and said, give Hur and his soldiers some water. Don't leave them thirsty. It's my enemy. He's the leader of the opposition. He has 1,000 men with him. No problem. Allah quenched my thirst when I was thirsty. How could I not quench another human's thirst? Number two, when he quenched some of their thirst, afterwards one of Hur's generals was called Ali bin Ta'an al-Muharibi. Ali bin Ta'an al-Muharibi was on the ground. Imam al-Hussein was on his horse. Ali bin Ta'an was a general for Umar bin Sa'ad. Imam al-Hussein was on the horse. Ali was on the ground. Ali looked at Imam al-Hussein when he was on his horse. He said, Hussein, you have any water? He said to him, yes, I do. He said, give it to me, please. General of Umar bin Sa'ad. General of the opposition. A man who's come with the literal purpose to behead you. He gave him the water. Ali bin Ta'an al-Muharibi trying to open the flask. It doesn't open. Tries to open. It doesn't open. Imam al-Hussein saw him. You will never see manners like this. He got off his horse. He came and sat by him. He told him in the Hijazi accent how to open the flask. Ali bin Ta'an was a Kufan. He never understood the Hijazi Arabic. So he said, I still don't understand you. Imam said, then give me the flask. He took it, he opened it for the general of Umar bin Sa'ad and gave it to him to drink. Tell me which man gives water to the opposition and to the generals of the opposition, yes? And that's why you found that that area of water would remain something Ahlul Bayt would never forget about Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. But how could you leave Hussein thirsty when he quenched your thirst? Imam Zain al-Abidin, when he done the grave of Imam al-Husayn, he wrote on the grave, هذا قبر الحسين بن علي. Yes? مذبوح عطشان. This is the grave of Hussein, son of Ali, killed thirsty. Aba Abdullah. You know Umar bin Sa'ad on the night of the 11th of Muharram, you know what Umar bin Sa'ad did? You know the children of Imam Hussein, all of them were thirsty, wasn't it? So it's the afternoon, Imam Hussein's been killed, all these children are thirsty, he didn't offer them any water. Then when Imam Hussein was killed, Umar bin Sa'ad comes, he says, drink some water, you, Sukaina, here. And she turned around and she said, how can I drink water when my father died thirsty? Tonight is your night. Tonight is your night, brothers and sisters. Tonight is with Aba Abdullah in Karbala tonight. So, he went to Imam Zain al-Abidin. He said to him, Ali ibn al-Husayn. He went towards Imam Zain al-Abidin. One narration mentions, but he said to him, listen, these children are not drinking any water. One narration mentioned Sayyidah Zainab, he went to her and he said, these children aren't drinking any water. She said, because their father died thirsty. He said, well, force them to drink, they're gonna die. Let them drink some quickly. As soon as he gave it to one of the daughters of Imam al-Husayn, she ran out towards the battlefield. Where is my father? He died thirsty. How can we drink water when Aba Abdullah died thirsty? Let me take you further on this issue of the thirst, yes? Imam al-Rada was sitting with Da'bal bin Ali al-Khuza'i. He said to him, Da'bal, recite lines for us, for Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, correct? Da'bal began the lines, أفاطم ولو خلت الحسين مجدلا وقد مات عطشانا بشط فرات. Oh Fatima, had you seen Hussein laid down? He died thirsty by the Furat, yes? إذن للطمت الخد فاطمة عنده. Fatima, you would have slapped your cheeks had you seen him thirsty on the ground, yes? At this moment they said, Da'bal, Da'bal, stop reciting. He said, why? They said, Imam al-Rada has fainted. Ahlul Bayt never forgot Aba Abdullah's thirst, never. Never did they forget the thirst of the 10th of Muharram. So they said, Imam al-Rada has fainted. Imam al-Rada had fainted. When they brought him back, he said, Da'bal, recite for me the lines again. He said, أفاطم لو خلت الحسين مجدلا وقد مات عطشانا بشط فرات إذا للطمت الخد أفاطم عنده. This is proof that we can slap our cheeks and we can slap our chests. Anyone who tells you it's not allowed, this is a ma'soom saying nothing about this act. He is accepting it. There is no problem if a person slaps their cheek or if a person beats their chest. It's nothing for Aba Abdullah. Again he recited. Again they said to him, Da'bal, Da'bal, stop. They said to him, why? He said, Ali ibn Musa has fainted again. Imam al-Rada faints twice? Again they said to him, Da'bal, recite the lines, أفاطم لو خلت الحسين مجدلا وقد مات عطشانا بشط فرات إذا للطمت الخد فاطم عنده وأجريت دمع العين في الوجنات, correct? At this moment Imam al-Rada had fainted again. When eventually Imam al-Rada got up, Da'bal bin Ali al-Khuza'i looked at him, he said, oh grandson of Rasulullah, why did you faint three times when I was reciting? He said, because as soon as you said that, oh Fatima, you would have seen him on the ground and you would have slapped your cheeks, I saw my grandmother in front of me slapping her cheeks. Fatima al-Zahra, when she hears the masaib of Aba Abdullah, she's amongst us, yes? Tonight is your night, the night of Ashura. Every lover of Hussein, tonight is your night. He said, I saw my grandmother Fatima al-Zahra crying in front of me. He said, I saw my grandmother Fatima al-Zahra crying in front of me. And that's why you find that Aba Abdullah, all he asked for at the end of his life on the 10th of Muharram, all he had asked for was what? Just some water. He heard many cries, al-atash, al-atash. But there was one baby in his tent, there was no cry anymore. There was no cry. The mothers who've had babies, when you hear your baby cry, how much does it hurt you? Yet when you know that your baby is not making any sound, what does it tell you? Rabab was in the tent. She brought the 6-month-old baby to Imam al-Hussein. Yes, she brought it to Sayyida Zainab. Sayyida Zainab brought the baby to Imam al-Hussein. She said, oh Hussein, Rabab says she can't hear anything from the baby anymore. And Rabab says, this is your baby. This is Al Muhammad's baby. Yes. So she said, oh Aba Abdullah, at least let them quench his thirst. This is a 6-month-old baby. If they want to kill us, kill us. But the 6-month-old baby, what has the baby done wrong? Imam al-Hussein, he took the baby, yes. Imam al-Hussein walked out towards the army of Umar bin Sa'ad. He said, oh army of Umar bin Sa'ad, if you want to kill me, kill me. But what crime has this baby committed, yes? Some of the soldiers of Umar bin Sa'ad turned around and said, okay, give the baby some water. But Umar bin Sa'ad said, no way, I'll kill the baby, and in the process I'll kill Hussein. So Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam noticed nobody came out to quench the thirst of this baby. So Imam al-Hussein went in the middle of the battlefield, yes. He went and he put the baby on the ground. He said, oh army of Umar bin Sa'ad, I will walk away now. The baby is on the heat of the ground of Karbala. At least one of you come out, one of you come and quench his thirst. But none of them came out. Imam al-Hussein came back, he took the baby, yes. When he came back and took the baby one more time, he called out, oh army of Umar bin Sa'ad, I beg you, one of you, just one of you, give me some water for this baby. Again, nobody gave anything. Umar bin Sa'ad turned around towards Harmala bin Kahil. He said to him, Harmala, prepare the arrow. Harmala bin Kahil prepared the arrow. Nobody narrates this better than Mukhtar al-Thaqafi. Mukhtar caught Harmala 5 years after Karbala, yes? When he caught him, he asked him, he said, Harmala, what did you do on the 10th of Muharram? He said, I shot 7 arrows towards the army of Hussein, yes? 4 of them hit their target and 3 of them missed. So at that moment, Mukhtar said, which of them hit their target? He said, the first arrow that hit its target was an arrow I struck on the right eye of Abul Fadl al-Abbas when he was on his horse. Every love of Abbas, this is your moment, yes? He said, I saw Abbas on his horse, I struck an arrow into his right eye. He said, normally when someone falls, they fall with their hands in front of them. He said, I saw Abbas fall on the ground with the arrow going straight through his eye. At this moment, Mukhtar said to him, how about second arrow? He said, the second arrow I shot on the nephew of Hussein bin Ali, Abdullah ibn al-Hassan. He said to him, what do you mean? He said, Hussein bin Ali was not lying on the ground. I saw some of the whiteness of his neck. So Umar bin Sa'ad said, strike the middle of his neck with your arrow. He said, I was about to strike. I saw a young boy running out of the tent with his auntie Zainab running after him. He said, I saw this young boy running out of the tent calling out, how dare you kill my uncle in front of me. He said, I ran towards the base. I said, I saw him run towards the body of Aba Abdullah. He said, I struck the arrow directly on that young boy. He said, the young boy turned around to his uncle and he said, oh my uncle, are you proud of me? He then looked at him, he said, oh Harmala, how about the third arrow? He said, the third arrow is the one that hurts me until today. Imagine, even Harmala got hurt. He said, the third arrow is the one that hurts me until today. He said to him, what do you mean? He said, the third arrow I struck on the 6-month-old baby of Hussein. He said to him, what happened when you struck it? He said, when I struck the arrow, I saw the baby flap its hands like a bird flaps its wings. He said to him, how about the fourth arrow? He said, the fourth arrow I struck on the chest of Aba Abdullah. Imam al-Hussein, when the baby flapped his hands, the blood was everywhere. Imam al-Hussein walked back to the tent. He came back, he walked back, he came back 7 times. And they called out, Hussein, what's wrong with you? He said, I don't know how to tell a mother that her baby's neck is pierced. Imam al-Hussein did not tell Rabah. Brothers and sisters, do you know who told Rabah? Zainab. Zainab, Umm al-Masa'ib. Sayyida Zainab walked towards Rabab. She said to her, Rabab, today has been a day of Masa'ib. So Rabab looked at her. She said, yes, I know. She said, you know that Abbas has died. She said, yes, I know. She said to her, you know that Akbar has died. She said, yes, I know. She said to her, you know that Qasim has died. She said, yes, I know. She said, Rabab, your son has joined the other Shuhada of Al-Muhammad. Brothers and sisters, on the night of the 11th of Muharram, a lot of these women were in the tent. They were crying over their beloved ones. Sayyida Zainab thought to herself, let me go and look for Rabab. Let me see where she is. She looked everywhere. She couldn't find Rabab. But then she looked in the middle of the battlefield. She saw Rabab walking around. She said to her, Rabab, Rabab, what's wrong with you? She said, I'm looking for my baby. I want to give some milk to my baby. Allahu Akbar, may Allah bless your tears. Brothers and sisters, on the 40th of Imam al-Hussein, when they returned back to Karbala, I want to narrate this narration for you. One of the Maraja, when he heard this narration, he fainted when he heard it, yes? And this narration is not easy to take. When they came back to Karbala after Sham, they came back to put the heads back with the bodies. Imam Zain al-Abidin came with the head of Imam al-Hussein, yes? Imam Zain al-Abidin came with the head of Imam al-Hussein. He dug the grave where he had buried the body of Imam al-Hussein. He put the head next to the body, yes? And this moment, there was a miracle that occurred. Imam Zain al-Abidin says, I put the head of Imam al-Hussein back with the body. Then all of a sudden, I heard a voice from the grave. The baby, I beg you, place the baby on my chest, yes? the baby, I beg you, place the baby on my chest and softly, softly put his neck on my neck. Yes, Abba Abdullah. The baby, put him on my chest and softly, softly place his neck on my neck. Oh my son, don't you know that the arrow still burns me when I remember it? Even after Karbala, they remembered it. But for this Rabab, she loved her baby. She cried for the baby in Karbala. Then she cried for the baby in Kufa. Then she cried for the baby in Sham. Then she cried for the baby in Karbala. But when she returned to Medina, there was only one she cried for. When she entered her house, she returned to Medina. She entered her house. She asked some builders, I beg you, remove the roof of my house. They said to her, are you sure? She said, yes, I don't want a roof on my house. They said to her, why? She said, how can I have a roof on my house to protect me from the sun when Abu Abdullah's body was not protected from the sun on the 10th of Muharram? إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. May Allah bless your tears. Ya Allah, raise us with Muhammad and Al Muhammad. Ya Allah, on this the night of Ashura, write us amongst the lovers of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. For those of you who really want to be amongst the lovers, raise your hand and beg. It's not a night to keep your hands by your side. It doesn't show any begging. Raise your hand, say, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, raise us as a lover of Muhammad and al-Muhammad. Ya Allah, write for us that we are one of the zuwar of Arafah. Ya Allah, write for us that we are one of the zuwar of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. Ya Allah, allow us to rub our cheeks on the grave of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. Imam al-Sadiq says, oh Allah, have mercy on those cheeks that rub themselves on the grave of Imam al-Hussein. Ya Allah, let these cheeks rub themselves on the grave of Imam al-Hussein. Ya Allah, on this the night of Ashura, look after all our brothers in the Muslim world. Ya Allah, our brothers in Bahrain, our brothers in the Hijaz, our brothers in Pakistan, our brothers in India, in Afghanistan, in Lebanon. Ya Allah, our brothers protecting the haram of Sayyida Zainab in Sham. Ya Allah, protect the haram of Sayyida Zainab alayhi salam. Ya Allah, allow us to return back to Sayyida Zainab alayhi salam. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this, the night of Ashura, for the originators of this majlis. Ya Allah, allow them to continue to serve Muhammad and Al Muhammad. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all our brothers around the Islamic world. As you know, inshallah, tomorrow in the morning we will have the maqtal of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, will be recited here in the morning. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the Surah Al-Fatiha, but before it, the loudest of your salawat.